Hello, and thank you for joining us in worship this evening. I'd like to remind you that as part of our worship today, we have some special music from our bell choir, as well as a solo from Frank Gray. So I want to thank all those who are participating tonight through the music. Tonight in the service, we're going to be looking at Holy Communion. And this was a meal that Jesus instituted in the midst of the Passover. And so I'd like to invite you to prepare for that a little later on in the service by getting some bread and some wine and grape juice as we get ready to celebrate. Also, I'd like to remind you to join us again tomorrow as we come together to remember Good Friday and Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. And then join us again on Sunday morning as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus and the Easter celebration. And now, friends, as we gather, we do so in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please now join me in a moment of prayer. Eternal God, in the sharing of a meal, your Son established a new covenant for all people, and in the washing of feet, he showed us the dignity of service. Grant that by your power of the Holy Spirit, these signs of our life and faith may speak again to our hearts, feed our spirits, and refresh our bodies. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
1 Corinthians 11, 17-31, Correcting an Abuse of the Lord's Supper. In the following directives, I have no praise for you, for your meetings do more harm than good. In the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you, and to some extent I believe it. No doubt there have to be differences among you to show which of you have God's approval. So then, when you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper you eat. For when you are eating, some of you go ahead with your own private suppers. As a result, one person remains hungry, and another gets drunk. Don't you have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God by humiliating those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you? Certainly not in this matter. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this, whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But if we were more discerning with regard to ourselves, we would not come under such judgment.
Thank you.
Friends, tonight is a sacred night known as Holy Thursday or Maundy Thursday. The word Maundy comes from a Latin word, mandatum, which means mandate or command, and it refers to the command Jesus gave the disciples to love others as he has loved us. Now, the events that took place on this night in the life of Jesus are among the most remarkable in all of his ministry. And whereas John tells us about the washing of the disciples' feet, it's Matthew, Mark, and Luke who tell us that it was on this night that Jesus celebrated the Last Supper with his disciples. And the context of that particular meal was, of course, the Passover, a special meal commemorating the Exodus from Egypt. Now, personally, as I read the scriptures, I'm constantly amazed at the frequency with which something special happens over a meal. You know, I'm remembering in the book of Exodus how Abraham prepared a special meal for the visitors who came to his house. I'm reminded, too, of the meal that the father of the prodigal son gave the whole community when the son returned home. And we're told that he welcomed his son, he kissed him, and welcomed him with a warm embrace. He also slaughtered the prize calf, which was an indication that this meal was going to be for the whole community. And the reason for that celebration was because this son who was lost is now found. And that son who was dead is now alive. And then I'm also amazed at the number of times Jesus celebrated a meal with those who were considered the lowest of the low. But sharing a meal with them was a way that Jesus would identify and walk alongside them. But sharing a meal together, if you were to look at Scripture, had a very special role. And really, that's not all that different from us today, because people will share birthdays, couples will celebrate anniversaries, business deals are often cemented over a meal. Now, sharing a meal with extended family or friends is not something many of us have done over the last year or so, and many of us are looking forward to that time when we can share a meal together in the future. But sharing a meal was what Jesus was doing with his disciples on this particular night, and they were fulfilling the command to celebrate the Passover. And it was at the Passover meal that Jesus instituted Holy Communion. This was an act recorded not only by Matthew, Mark, and Luke, but by Paul as well. And Paul writes about it in the 11th chapter of his first letter to the Corinthians. Now, the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians is of great importance for a couple of different reasons. One reason is because it records the first words of Jesus, but it also provides an example for us about what life was like in the early church as they came to celebrate Holy Communion. And I wish I could come before you tonight and say there was much that Paul commended the church about, but that would be stretching the truth because Paul had very little that he was complimentary of. You know, Paul, as he looked at these early Christians, he criticized them. One of the criticisms that Paul labeled against the early Christians was that they forgot their manners. And as I've said in sermons past, manners are a whole lot like zero, not much by themselves, but they add so much to everything else. But Paul was critical of these early Christians because as they gathered for a meal, some arrived early and began to eat before the others could arrive. Now, communion was to be a meal where all the barriers were to be tumbled down. There wasn't to be a barrier of race. There wasn't to be a barrier of wealth. None of that was to take place at when people came together, Christians came together to celebrate communion. But that's not the way it was in the early church. In fact, the rich would often separate themselves from the poor, leaving the poor to fend for themselves, and they would begin to eat before the poor would all arrive. It's kind of interesting that one of the earliest sermons we have in outside of Scripture comes to us from the second century, and this was a pastor, again, who was addressing second century Christians, and this is what he said to the congregation he was addressing on that particular day. He begins to talk about manners, and this is what he says. Don't cram food into your mouth as if you were packing for a journey. And don't try to eat and drink at the same time. And then he goes on to talk about extravagant things, asking, won't a knife cut without a jeweled handle? In other words, do you have to have the finest of silverware in order to cut a loaf of bread? And does the table in which you cut that loaf of bread, does it really require ivory legs? You know, after all, the preacher pointed out, Jesus ate from a common bowl and made the disciples have the people sit on grass. But Paul's point in Holy Communion was simply that communion was an act of God directed toward us. But also communion, Paul made it known that communion was an act of humanity that responds to God's grace. You see, Paul wanted Christians to demonstrate their faith through lives of service and humility and love. And that quality of life should be seen in Christians whenever they come together to celebrate a meal, especially a meal as sacred as Holy Communion. Now today, as I think to the habits I learned while growing up, many of these habits revolved around meals. I remember one habit, these were things my parents taught me, but one habit I learned was to offer a word of thanks at each meal. And Paul tells us that when Jesus, when he had taken bread, he gave thanks, and then he broke it and gave it to his disciples. Well, offering a word of thanks is something that many of us are accustomed to. You know, growing up, the prayer in my family was, "Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest. Let this food to us be blessed. Amen." And that was a prayer we said often before we shared a meal together. But I came across another prayer that I've said from time to time, and it goes like this. "Bless, O Lord, these delectable victuals. May they add to thy glory and not to our middles." You know, I kind of find a little humor in that. But we're told in Scripture, Paul reminds us that Jesus gave thanks before he distributed the bread. And what exactly he said in that prayer of thanks, we're not told, but he gave thanks. And I think it would be helpful for us to pause every now and then, every meal, to just simply offer a word of thanks or to express thanks in some other form. Now, another habit I learned growing up from my parents was to leave at a decent hour if we were dinner guests in the home of another. Some of you might remember the little admonition that Ogden Nash wrote for guests. And this is what he said. "Guests should leave at an hour auspicious unless they intend to help with the dishes." You know, I find that pretty good advice. But etiquette is more than just a list of do's and don'ts. Rather, I think etiquette is a guideline for us on how we can be thoughtful and considerate of others. But meals can be a very special and rewarding time if we all remember our manners. Our mealtimes can also provide testimony for how we've lived. You know, I've shared this story in the past. It's a story concerning Rabbi Abraham Heschel. As he was getting up there in age, he began to kind of ponder the prospect of his death. And we're told that right after the noon meal, he got up, he recited the benediction, and then he began to pace the floor very, very slowly, just back and forth. And as he's walking back and forth, he was thinking about his life and who would give testimony as to how he lived. And then as the story goes, his face lit up because in front of him was his table. And he walked over to his table and he laid his hands on it. And he said, "Good table, you will give testimony that I have at your boards properly prayed and properly lived out my life." And then when evening set in, he gave instruction to his son to have his table dismantled and the coffin built from its boards because he knew that table would give testimony to how he lived day to day, week to week, month to month, and year to year. And that story just makes me ask, what would the table we eat around most say about our lives? Would it speak of our humble prayers? Would it speak of our gracious words? Would it speak of our kind deeds? You know, Paul encouraged Christians to come together to the table in a worthy manner. He wasn't just talking about proper table etiquette, though that certainly was a part of it. But more to the point, what Paul, I think, was talking about was that we should understand the price that Christ paid to give us his body and his blood. What Paul is saying is that cost Christ his life. And once we understand that, once we really come to grips with that, we're ready to receive this sacrament. And so I invite you tonight to prepare yourself at this time, for in a few moments you will be invited to receive his body, which is broken for you, and to receive his blood, which is shed for you. And why do we do it? Well, it comes with a promise for the forgiveness of sin. So may God bless you on this holy night, this night of among all nights, when we remember what Christ has done for us and we respond to that gracious act. Amen.
when sorrow burdened, a vision came to me, a vision of my Master and his Gethsemane. I saw his face uplifted, his prayer just begun, as he whispered, "O my Father, thy will, not mine, be done. If you come to your own Gethsemane and you see the dreary years stretching away before you, filled with naught but tears, remember thy Master in the garden and his strength he'll give to thee. This Prince of Pain and who lives again in thy Gethsemane." Oftimes when I am dreaming, a city fair I see, with walls of gold and jasper, beside a tranquil sea, I see the Master waiting, and know 'twas not in vain that in that lonely garden he bore alone his pain. If you come to your own Gethsemane and you see the dreary years stretching away before you, filled with naught but tears, remember thy Master in the garden and his strength he'll give to thee. This Prince of Men who lives again in thy Gethsemane.
And now, friends, as we prepare to receive Holy Communion, I'd like to invite you to join with me in a confession as we come before the Lord, confessing our sin and then receiving the forgiveness of God. So let's join together in confession. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, friends, in the night in which our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and gave thanks. And then he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And then again after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And now let's join together in the prayer Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now the gifts of God for the people of God. The body of Christ broken for you. And the blood of Christ shed for you. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. And now, friends, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now, friends, go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.